Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Mats Mulder, and I'm a recent graduate from the TU Delft in the Netherlands and Aalto University in Finland. And today I'm going to tell you something about the research that I conducted as part of my master thesis. And I did this in collaboration with Oana Inel, and Nava Tintreff and Jasper Oosterman. It's called Operationaling Framing to Support Multi-Perspective Recommendations of Opinion Pieces. In recent years, we saw a rise of news recommender systems. In a recent study, we saw that 23% stated that online media is their main news resource. And also 44% considers digital and traditional as equals. We also saw an increased use of digital boards, so platforms that are only digital, and also news aggregating services that do not create their own content, but aggregate the content of different sources. But we also saw that there's a heavy debate coming up about the role of news recommender systems in this democratic society. And I think the most well-known example of this is the debate on filter bubbles, which was initiated by Pariser in 2011. And to look a little bit into this debate, we have to look at into literature about the democratic role of news media. And generally, in literature, two functions are recognized. The first one is the watchdog function, which states that's the responsibility of news media to inform citizens about important issues that are going on. And the second one is to create a diverse public forum in which different ideas and opinions are being heard. It depends, however, a little bit on the democratic theory that you follow. So the theory about which aspects are important to sustain a democratic society. For example, the liberal model is very different from the deliberative model, and they put different weights on those functions I described. An interesting thing is actually that it also can be conflicting in recommender systems. So for example, a recommender system that is optimized to be diverse, to create this diverse public forum, can increase this function of being a watchdog. So we performed actually a research that is related to the second function. And that's because if you look into how diversity now is being adapted in recommender systems, you see that the current diversification methods are not really applicable in the news domain. You see that there are actually two main diversification methods. The first one is based on source diversity, such that it includes different sources into the recommendations and thereby hopes to also increase the viewpoint diversity. But of course, this is no direct measure. And secondly, content diversity, which is often still based on just the diversity of topics. So for example, including both something about the Black Lives Matter and the US elections to be diverse. But of course, this is also not viewpoint diversity. So we see that there is a need for novel diversification methods that can really do viewpoint diversification. And thereby, it would be good to have an interdisciplinary approach such that this sort of understanding of the role of news media in a democratic society and in a social domain can be bridged to the computational domain, the way diversity in recommender systems is understood. But we also need to understand the effect of these viewpoint diversification methods on the user. And we need to do this in real online scenarios, because in the end, if we are able to create viewpoint diverse recommendations, users should also be willing to consume those. And we also need to know what the effect of this diversification is on other important features of the recommender systems. So that's why we set up a research in collaboration with Blendl, which is a Dutch news aggregating service. And they have a platform in which, for monthly subscriptions, users get around 20 to 25 news articles. The first part is based on an editorial pick, and the second one is based on a recommender system. And we set up two research questions at the beginning. The first one is that we want to find out what the effect is of this viewpoint diversification on the reading behavior. And the second one is that we want to find out if the reading if behavior is also affected by the presentation characteristics, because articles can be presented differently on the platform, for example, with an image or without a thumbnail image. And as a first step, we wanted to find a definition of diversity that can be operationalized in the recommended systems. And for that, we used the framing theory, which is a well-known theory in communication science, and says that because the reality is too complex to be fully understood, every article contains a specific frame on an issue. You also always have to choose what to include and what not to include. And one of the most known definitions of a frame is the one from Edman, which describes a frame by four aspects, or functions, as he calls it. The first one is the problem definition, and describes the main issue under investigation in the frame. The second one are the causal attributions, so the forces that contribute to the problem, and a moral evaluation of those forces. And finally, possibly treatment recommendations can be given in a frame, so possible solutions to the problem. So one example can be, for example, about the second corona wave. And the problem definition can be that we're heading for a second corona wave. And the causal attributions can, for example, be the REVM or the majors of Amsterdam and Rotterdam. And they can be evaluated in the following way, that the RVM is stubborn about the use of mouth masks, which is negative, and that the majors of Amsterdam and Rotterdam do take the responsibility, which is evaluated positively. And a possible treatment recommendation then could be that there should be a national duty to wear mouth masks. The question then, of course, is how can we bridge this definition of framing in the social domain to the computational domain? And to do that, we set up a focus group in which the main objective was to find a bridge towards the framing functions to the computational domain. Therefore, we asked different experts working at Blendl, which all had a background in communications sciences or journalism, and we asked them to decompose articles and based on Edman's framing functions. And we discussed the results of this analysis in a review session afterwards. And the main outcome is actually that the structure of opinion pieces can be used as a main heuristic to extract these framing functions from an article. Often in the introduction paragraph of the article, the problem definition is described. And the body paragraphs are used to talk about different attributions of the problem and give an evaluation of these attributions. And finally, if there are treatment recommendations given, they often can be found in the concluding paragraph. So for example, of this article, that we already use as an example. The problem definition we are adding for the second corona wave is an introduction, and the body paragraphs is the information about the RVM and the majors, and the treatment recommendation about the national duty for mouth masks can be found in the concluding paragraphs. So the question then, of course, is if we use this structure, then how can we calculate the frame distance between an article A and B? And therefore, we set up a pipeline that first extracts metadata from those articles that can be related to those four framing functions. So on the left, you see an article coming in. We split it into introduction paragraphs, body paragraphs, and concluding the paragraphs. We possibly translate it and we process it. And then we have an extraction method, the main extraction method, to extract metadata related to each framing functions. So on the right, you see the information 1 to 4 that relates to the four framing functions. Then we want to compare articles based on this information. So we have implemented a pipeline that compares two articles A and B in terms of this information that we extracted. So on the left, you see the information of two articles related to those four framing functions coming in. We implemented a distance function for them, and we used a normal sum to create a viewpoint diversity score, which measures the distance in terms of frame functions between article A and B. The question then, of course, is now we have this frame diversity score, how can we use it in a recommender system? And therefore, we use the MMR, the maximal marginal relevance algorithm. And this algorithm is a well-known algorithm to get some diversity into a recommendation list. So it actually re-ranks in the recommendation lists based on a linear combination between relevance and diversity. On the right, you see an example of this. You see in recommendation lists that's coming in, and an MMR with Lambda 0.5, which means 50% relevance and 50% diversity, and a re-ranked list is coming out. And for example, if we set the MMR to Lambda 0, a different list is coming out because now it's fully re-ranked on diversity. In normal case, this diversity score is often this source or topic diversity, which I told you about. But in our case, we will implement our viewpoint diversity score here. And for the relevance, because it's not our focus in this study, we just use a simple TF-IDF score based on the article content of the two articles. Now we have a method, a pipeline to perform this viewpoint diversification. We need to know if the method is indeed capable of increasing the viewpoint diversity score. And therefore, we set up an offline evaluation in which we re-ranked data sets for different values of Lambda. And we measured viewpoint diversity according to a metric that we found in literature. And this metric measures viewpoint diversity based on the intralist diversity, based on 50% channels and 50% LDA topics. And we also performed some additional measurements, including the list size, the effect of the list size, the effect of the cross-validation parameter that we use in the offline evaluation, and the effect on the publisher ratio. The main result I want to, first the data that we used. We created four different data sets, and those were about ongoing disputed topics at those time, such that different frames were included to the data set. And it was done in collaboration with the Blendl experts. And we found four topics that were actually possible at that time, and the Black Lives Matter protests, coronavirus, US elections, and the privacy concerns around big technology firms. And we could include around 40 to 70 articles per data set. The main result I wanted to show you in this presentation is that the viewpoint diversity score actually increased according to the metric. And the easiest way to see this is that when the value of Lambda decreases in the figures on the right, so on the left you see Lambda value of 0, we actually see that the diversity score in red increases. Thus, the viewpoint diversity score is actually increasing for a higher contribution of diversity in an MMR algorithm. And thereby, we verify the capability of the method according to the metric. But also, we wanted to know if the users are in the end also willing to read those more diverse recommendations. So that's why my colleagues at Blendl implemented a new functionality on the platform. And here you see a reading page. You see the last paragraph of an article on top. And below, we are now able to include recommendations on the same topic. The title is also called Read Further on this topic. And in an experiment of 2 weeks, we created those recommendation sets of three articles below two articles every day for two different groups of users. And those included around 1,000 active users. And the baseline users got recommendation sets with only relevant articles compared to the original article. And the diverse users got viewpoint diverse articles. And we only used the Lambda value 1 and 0 in this experiment. And we measured the reading behavior according to four metrics. The first one is the click-through rate calculated per article, so from the original article to the recommended article. Then also the click-through rate per set, and that's because it's more, you can actually only choose one article from the recommendation set. The fourth one is the completion rate of the recommendations, which can be a sort of indication for how how happy users were with the recommendations. And the fourth one is the heart rate, and that's the number of users that selected the recommendation as their favorite, and that's being done by clicking on the small heart. And that's why it's called the heart rate, of course. The results show that that there was no major influence on the reading behavior. Only for the click-through rate calculated per set, we saw that the baseline users, the click-through rate per set for the baseline users was around 6.5% higher. But we also looked at the presentation characteristics, and we saw that those have for some presentation characteristic, there's a positive influence. And that was, for example, at the click-through rate, where the inclusion of a thumbnail image had a positive influence on the click-through rates. And also, we saw that the number of hearts that are shown, which represents the number of people that, selected the article as their favorite, also can positively influence the click-through rate. Then I come to the conclusion and of a discussion and limitations of my study. So we saw that the method is indeed capable of increasing the viewpoint diversity score according to a metric. But we also have to sort of understand that this relation of the metric with the human perception of diversity is unknown. As I told you, it's based on 50% channels and 50% LDA, but it's not really known how this relates to how we see diversity or different viewpoints. Also, we've seen that the presentation characteristics have a significant influence on the results, and it's just important to address these effects in future research on viewpoint diversification. We also have seen that there's a remarkable high viewpoint diversity score in the offline study compared to other work. And a possible explanation of this is that there was both an LDA model in the diversification method and in the metric. So there can be an interference between those two. And this also brings me to the limitations. There's a sort of limited evaluation performed of the extraction methods. So we do not exactly know how well in the end the extraction methods that are described cover the framing aspects. And it would be interesting to also put effort in sort of optimizing these extraction methods. Then also the online study was limited, first by the different values of lambda that was used. Now we only considered lambda 0, 1, but it would also be interesting to see values of lambda in between, and also different list size than 3, and more topics than only 4 topics can be considered. Additionally, we also only selected the active users. Additionally, we didn't measure the user perception during the online evaluation, so not how diversity was perceived by users at the time. And also, where I told you about, we see that the presentation characteristics do have an influence, but those presentation characteristics can also be a marker of quality for the users, and thereby they can influence, for example, the click-through rate. So these questions should also be addressed in future research. Well, thank you for your time and attention. I'm happy to answer all your questions related to those to this research. I also wanted to say that we have a public GitHub in which I described the method, the diversification method, and also included different articles as an example. You can always contact me if you have any questions about that. And also, I'm currently looking for my first job, so if you have any tips on that, that's also very welcome. Thank you again.